Thank you. sabrán cuánto te amo. Cuando por fin seamos dos, yo nunca estuve tan segura de amar sin condición. Mirándote, mi amor, te juro, cuidar por siempre nuestra unión. Hoy te prometo amor eterno, ser para siempre. The best that ever happened to me was meeting you for the first time. Now standing here hand in hand is what I've always dreamt of. Today the end. Hoy te prometo amor eterno, ser para siempre. Tuyo en el bien y el mal, hoy te demuestro cuánto te quiero, amándote a hasta mi final. Today I promise before our Father I will love you until the
It is my privilege to welcome everyone here. You have given us the gift of your presence. It is one of the greatest gift that a friend, a family can give to each other. And there is someone very special that would like to be present as well. It's the Heavenly Father who brought those two together and brought us all together. So would you please stand again as we ask our Heavenly Father to be with us. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to witness this miracle as you brought Aaron and Katie together. We ask you please to bless each person that is here today. Allow us, Lord, to learn from this experience, to confirm our commitment to each other as friends, as spouses. Allow us to use this opportunity, Lord, to know that you are the God in our lives, and that we need no one. Bless us today, in the name of Christ we ask, amen. Please be seated. This message is for Aaron and for Katie. It is amazing how powerful words can be. You know, we use words for many things in life. And the profession that the two of you chose, they are your tools. As you serve people, as you share your love to each other, words are a very powerful thing. And they describe every single step that we take in life. So there is a word that came to my mind, a word that both of you are very familiar with. You have heard it probably hundreds of times, maybe thousands of times, I don't know. But today, this word will have a different meaning from now on in your lives. Be ready? The word is mission. Mission. Is there no romance in that word, mission? Yes, there is. Mission is about relationship. Mission is about commitment. Mission is about giving. It's about loving. It's about serving each other. So mission describes your relationship very well. Very well indeed. Now, you came from the East, 2,000 some miles away. And she is from here, from the West. You know, think about mission. For the two of you to get together is like a mission impossible. Because if you look at the map, you are far away. And she is this extreme. And there are millions of people between. And how is possible that the two of you got together? Yes, the Lord sent you to Southern California for an event. He told her to go there. And you had a little walk together. 4 months went by. God sent you back to Northern California. And then as you speak to young people, your eyes saw some young eyes. You look her eyes, she look your eyes, and the mission started. The journey started. He asked her for a date, but before he came to an admission, I need this girl to walk beside me for a longer while. And so you ask her, do I have, Katie, your permission to walk beside you? And she says, yes. What she meant is, I like to admit, I like to walk beside you as well. And so the journey started, and the mission went on, and there was quite a few more walking. And I think that both of you came to the mission because you're both health conscious. This walking together is good for our heart. So let's do it more of it. And you did more talking and more walking. And one day, she brought you to meet my wife and I. And from that point on, I know why she chose you. I know why you're so special to her. Because I know this girl very well. I have been around her for quite a while. I pray for her birth long before she was even conceived. So I know her very well. And whatever she learns to love, it must be lovable because she knows how to love. I understand that after that, you came a few more times to this part of the country. And you met her sister, her brother, their families, and then even came to a Christian wedding. Oh, was Christian was getting married. Yeah, I believe he's here too. And so you met more family members. Now was the time for Katie to meet your family. But you came to another admission. You decide to call my wife and I to ask permission to ask her to marry you. Yes. And then what happened? We gave you our blessing. You made a decision to walk beside her for the rest of your life. Now you start planning. When? The big day? Where? How? You made all that yourself, right? That was your mission, to get everything right. Then Katie had to go to Maryland to meet your beloved father and mother.
and your sister and her family, your friends. So she went, and you asked us to go there too. But she did not know, right? That was our mission, to keep the secret. So we went, and August the 24th, 2022, in the afternoon, according to your plan, your father, your mother, my wife and I had to go for a long walk, very long walk, up to the hill, to a hilltop. You know, you were, since you have been here, you have heard this hilltop a lot, right? Hilltop. So we went to a hilltop. Your parents have a bag with quite a few items. You want them to set up what I like to call a proposal sanctuary. All the setup ready. And then we find a place to hide, a few feet away, and we wait. And here comes Aaron and Katie for a walk. Katie was convinced that this was another walk just for good for her heart. She had no idea how much this walk is going to affect her heart for the rest of her life. But it came to a place, Katie looked, all the setup, and then you start to explaining the meaning of everything. She started listening, but she heard you very well when you got in your knees. She realized that that was the time you're going to ask her to marry her. He asked, and you said yes. And then, yes, of course. Make sure. Yes, yes, of course. Actually, when you ask her to marry, when you ask her to marry you, what you were asking her, Katie, I'd like your footprints to be beside me for the rest of my life. And when she said yes, she said, I want your footprints to be right beside me for the rest of my life. That was part of the mission. Then you decide after, I need to make a call. And you call the Heavenly Father. And you ask him for his permission and for his blessings. The two of you held hands, and you decided, how do we get the best connection to the Father above? On your knees. And the connection was perfect. He granted you permission, he gave you his blessings, and then after you pray, you, Aaron, said, Katie, let's call your parents. Let's give them the good news. You dial, the call went up, searching for a satellite to go all the way to California. Nope. There is a place in California where we live, it's called Escondido. Do you know what that means? Hidden. We live in the top of a hill. Do you know what the name of the hills? Hidden Hills. But the signal didn't go to Escondido. It didn't go for that place. It went to another hiding place, just a few feet away. And then you said, I'd like to give you a good news. I proposed to your daughter. She said, yes, we are officially engaged. And Katie said, oh, I wish you were here. And then she heard her mama say, we are here. We are all here. And to see the expression of her eyes was the most precious thing, that a memory that we'll never erase from our minds. Then, as a family, the two families, we got together, and we also call our Heavenly Father. Our parents, as parents, we ask him to bless the decision that both of you made. We are very blessed that you made that decision. Now, this is the hill, the hilltop, where the proposal hill, the sanctuary. I would like to press a button, pause, because I want to illustrate what happens between this hilltop which I call the proposal hilltop, this hilltop that we call the commitment hilltop. Okay? A young boy, he enjoys so much biblical movies, stories. So one day there was this special showing of the Ten Commandments in town because it was called Holy Week or something they were showing. So the father said, I'm going to take my son there. He took the son to this place. It was huge. The seating capacity was enormous. They got in, they sit down, and they wait for the movie to start. You know, the Ten Commandments is 3 hours and 40 minutes. It's long. This is not going to be that long. Okay? And so what happened is that at that time, the movie started. The boy was fascinated. The sound quality, the image, he felt like he was part of the movie. And then something happened. The light came back on. The picture disappeared. And on the screen, from one end to the other, a huge word appeared. You want to guess what that word was? Intermission. But what kind of is that? He saw some people standing up. Some people were, but it looks like they were leaving. The boy became confused. He knew that the story doesn't end that way. So he looked at his father and says, what is going on? The father, stand up, son. Look the back. Way, way there in the back. Now look up, up, up. Do you see there a little window? There is someone there that is changing the wheels. Very soon, in a few minutes, the second part will be projected. That is the best part. In just a few minutes, the boy relaxed and sit down and waited. And just like the father said, the light went down and the second part, the best part, it started. Aaron, Katie, the proposal hilltop, from this commitment hilltop, there was intermission. There are a lot of people stressed out, working hard, trying to figure out what in the world is going on. But someone up there was just changing the wheels. So the best part could be projected. And the best part is going to start in just a few minutes. Now I want both of you and everybody else to have a close look at the word mission. Pretend that you can see the word mission. There's two I's in mission. I is for a person, individual. Aaron, look at mission. Your I is there. Katie, look at mission. Your I is there. Now, there is an S beside each one of you. That S stands for sight, meaning you are looking at each other. Look at the position of the letters. They are looking at each other. That S also stands for steps. You are walking towards each other. That is the mission part one. But what is the mission? Is to become one. Now, in order to understand that part, we have to go all the way to the beginning, to Genesis chapter 1 and 2. When God tells about the creation. The Bible says that everything was good. And then says, very good indeed. But chapter 2 says something. It says, after everything was created, the house was perfect. The earth, house perfect. Everything in it. But there is one thing missing. Adam was not a mission. The second I was missing. So instead of being a mission, Adam was a miss on. The second I was missing. And then God said, and I'm paraphrasing, it's not good for a man to be a miss on. I have to make him an eye, a perfect eye, to make him complete. And so God told Adam, close your eyes. And he fell asleep. And then God went beside him and took a bone. And with that, he created a perfect eye for Adam, so that his mission would be complete. And so that eye was created. And then he said, open your eyes, Adam. And he opened his eyes, and if he were Hispanic, he would say, aye, aye, aye. But he looked at the beautiful eye that God created for him, and immediately it was love at first sight. God said, I need to marry you. And he gave them a commission. The commission was, you have to take good care of your house, everything in it. And you have to become one. And you have to have little missions that will grow and fill your house. Right? And so that was when they finally became one. Now, if we go to the New Testament in the book of Matthew, chapter 28, you're very familiar, 18, 20, there's a commission there too. Now, the groom is Jesus Christ. The bride is the church. The application is the same, to multiply, teach them, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, the wedding version is different. It's the same one that you find in Genesis. You are to become one. You are to teach your children, your little ones. You are to keep them clean, wash them, so they can glorify God. That's the wedding version. Now, there's one more thing that you need to know. That S, besides the I, have another meaning. And that is the most important of them all. There is no marriage without this one. If you understand this part, your marriage will be last forever. Now look back in Eden. Their marriage lasts almost 1,000 years. Now, if you know the secret of this word, your marriage will last 1,000 years as well. The word you find when you see Christ as the groom, giving his bride the greatest gift ever. You know what's the gift that he gave them? He gave everything that he has, everything that he is. He gave her the gift of submission. He gave her his life. She loved him so much. She gives him everything she has, everything she is. She also gives him the gift of submission. She gives him her life. Then they become one. Then the animation becomes memories, becomes moments, becomes a monument, becomes marriage. That's what the M stands for in your mission. Now you may say, but there is an O-N at the end of mission. In a few minutes, I'll tell you the meaning of that. Now there is one more thing, the honeymoon. You go all the way to Revelation. You see the groom, Jesus Christ, marrying his beautiful bride and take her to honeymoon for 1,000 years. And he built the mansion himself. Not 5 stars, a 1 billion stars mansion. And then after 1,000 years of honeymoon, he brings her back to a house, a brand new house that he built himself. And the two of them live together forever. That's the mission. We want your mission to be also 1,000 years. At this time, I know that the two of you would like to submit to each other some very beautiful words. So please.
Aaron. My dear Aaron, 7 years ago, I saw you for the first time. This young, good-looking, tall man, preaching passionately, serving God. And I was intrigued. But when I met you personally for the first time, I realized how different we were and wondered if something could ever develop. I even remember thinking on our first date-ish, as you rolled down the window yelling in excitement, I thought, oh boy, I don't know if we'll be a good fit. But what came next was an odd, inexplicable experience. I wondered if we'd fit, but God was telling me to trust him and move forward, that some way, somehow, you were good for me. And I don't remember the exact moment when I realized it or God fully revealed it to me. But you are not only good for me, you are absolutely perfect for me. I have random moments alone when I'm brought to tears to think of how perfect you are for me and how much I love you. I love your big, extroverted personality, how you love people, how you can connect with anyone. I see it all the time on airplanes, at potlucks, everywhere we go. And not just connecting, but your passion to help them, especially by sharing the love of God. I love how you're completely and unapologetically yourself, no reserves. When you sing your thoughts all the time, and my life feels like a Broadway show, even when sometimes I'm internally embarrassed, I love it. Your sincere way of laughing at times where things are not even that funny. But you genuinely think it's funny. I love how excited you are about the little things. This is the best food ever, baby. Have you tried this? When you see me after work and you excitedly run to me as if I haven't seen you in ages. I love how intelligent you are, creative you are, the way you think about things, the way that you present things, how many books you have. 6 bookshelves and counting. I love everything about you. But what I love most is how selfless and thoughtful you are. This shows me most the character of God. When you do errands for me, like change my tire or take my car to get gas when I'm tired, and you do it with so much joy. When you sprint to the car every time to turn on my seat warmer because it's cold, when I try to do something nice for you, when I try to do something nice for you and like massage your hand and you immediately without thinking start massaging my hand instead. I've always thought I've known God well, but it's been amazing to get to know him and his love better through your love. I don't just love you, I also love you and me together. I love reading and learning with you. I love planning with you, even wedding planning, somewhat. I love sharing food with you, laughing together, ministering together, editing PowerPoint slides together, traveling together. I love how we finish each other's grape juice. I love doing everything together and doing nothing together. I look forward to continuing all the above to grow old together, have rocking chairs. You're my person, my best friend, my Biffle, and my Biffy. And I want to do life together with two of my favorite people, you and God. So I promise to continue doing life together, to always fight with you, of fighting of who loves each other more, and I intend to win. Fight with who can try and share the last bite of food with one another. I promise to always support you in your ministry and in your goals. I promise to always love you. I know that challenges will come, internal and external, but I promise to commit to counting it all joy when they do, to always laugh together, and ultimately to promise Ephesians 5, to always put God first, but to submit to you, to respect you, to humble myself before the Lord and before you. I promise to always come before the Lord to seek his will in my thoughts, my feelings, my actions, and in everything I do. And I promise that although I will not and cannot be perfect, that I will ask God to cover me and my faults and make me the best wife that I can be for you and for him.
Hey, girl. To begin with, I need to acknowledge the elephant in the room. Everyone can see it. Everyone knows it. It's clear to all. I'm marrying up. You're more educated, better looking, even a better public speaker. And it's like my job to be a good speaker. I could go on and on. But what I mean more than these things is that you lift me up. You bring me higher, closer to our Most High God. Your sincere commitment and steadfastness to our Heavenly Father inspires me to be all that I can be for Him and for you. Today, I joyfully commit myself to the upward journey with you as we join our lives together and seek the Lord's blessing on our marriage, desiring to live in His presence, us in Him, and Him in us. Katie, before I met you, several people told me that you would be a perfect spouse. And now, after experiencing you all of this time, I realize that was not an exaggeration. You really are the perfect person for me. You are more than I have ever asked for or imagined. It certainly is true that God gives exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. A few days ago, someone asked me how my feet were doing. If I had any reservations about the wedding day, I told them confidently, my feet are warm, very, very warm, even hot. Katie, I have no reservations, nor ever will, about marrying you. On the first day I met you, you shared a worship thought with a group I was in. You mentioned, as a side point, that you had full confidence God intended for you to marry someone someday. Well, that day is today. And I'm sure pumped up that it's me. Getting to know you has been so easy and natural, making me feel like I've known you all my life. And without doubt, I'm committed to spending the rest of my life with you. Whatever life brings our way, I know we will bring it to the Lord in prayer, both individually and together. Katie, I promise to likewise lift you up in prayer, encourage you when you're down, hold you tight when times are tough, cry when you cry, like 20 minutes ago. Rejoice when you rejoice. Laugh when you laugh. I promise to continually humble myself before the Lord and before you, that He may lift us, that He may lift us up. I promise to keep our marriage honorable, pure, holy. I promise to put you before myself, not looking after my own interests, but considering you more important than myself and my opinions. Proverbs 31 asks the question, an excellent wife, who can find it? Me. I have. I found you. You're a true jewel, someone who will be an exceptional mother of 2 to 4 children. One at a time. A best friend, a true lover. Katie, I can't imagine life without you. People told me I needed a psychologist. Well, now I've got one for life. But much more, I've found a marvelous wife. You lift me up.
You're gonna need this. You're gonna need this, yeah. Because now you're with me. Yes. Now We'd like you to repeat after me. This is the traditional vows. I, Aaron, before God and in the presence of this witness,
before God and in the presence of these witnesses,
take you, Katie, to be my wife,
to live together with God in his presence,
in the sacred covenant of marriage, I promise to love you,
to honor you,
to cherish you, to have you and to hold you, in sickness and in health, in poverty or in wealth,
in the trials that will come our way,
in the blessings that will light our day, and forsaking all others,
be faithful only to you.
Now, Aaron, do you commit to keep these vows as long as both of you shall live?
I do.
Now, Katie, repeat after me. I, Katie. Before God and in the presence of these witnesses.
Before God and in the presence of these witnesses.
Take you, Aaron. To be my husband. To live together with God in his presence. In the sacred covenant of marriage. I promise to love you.
To honor you.
To cherish you. To have you and to hold you.
In sickness.
And in health. In poverty.
Or in wealth.
In the trials that will come our way. In the blessings that will light our day.
In the blessings that will light our days.
And forsaking all others. Be faithful only to you. So, Katie, do you commit to keep these vows as long as you both shall live?
I do.
Now we took care of the dues. This time, we'd like to invite the parents of Aaron, his sister and her family, and also the Elson family, their spouses, to come forward. They will make a circle around Katie and Aaron, and as we pray. Again, the parents, the siblings, and their families, please join hands and make a circle around us as Aaron and Katie and myself, we kneel in the middle, okay, in the center. Now, you can stand, yeah. You don't need to kneel, just us. Now, the audience may not see, but we have a Bible, and Aaron and Katie will put both hands on the top of the Bible. The symbolism is that the Word of God will be the foundation of their unity, will be the foundation of their lives together. It is the Lord who brought them together. It is the Lord who will keep them together. One thing that we did not mention, and we mention right now, is that mission has two eyes. And when they two become one eye, the other eye is the great I Am that will be always before them, will be always looking at them, will be always taking steps towards them, as long as they take steps toward the great I Am. So please, dear Heavenly Father, here are two of your children, two that you put together according to your purpose. Their journey starts now. We ask you please to guide them and give them the powers to keep themselves always in your presence. Allow them to have the wisdom to make right choices. Allow them to have a patience so that they can always walk side by side, not only of each other, but always side by side with you as well. Thank you so much for giving us the privilege to participate with them in this commitment. As this circle that is around them, symbolizing a circle of protection, allow each individual that is here now making this circle make themselves a commitment to be always a wall around Katie and Aaron. Allow them, Lord, to be the angels that you have sent to protect their marriage. We ask those blessings as now united them and to make them one. And as the two less letters in the word mission, now, Lord, you can put the mission on. Only now the mission is truly on, when they receive the blessing from above. We ask those blessings in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Starting our new lives, we're on our own, trusting Him to guide, hand in hand and side by side. Serving God together seems so right. So let's go on this journey with God. Let us praise Him together, serving as one. Let us look towards heaven, no matter what comes, as we go on this journey, on this journey. Thank you. this journey with God. Let us praise Him together, serving as one. Let us look towards heaven, no matter what comes, as we go on this journey. On this journey.
By the privilege of being called as a minister of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the state of California, I now declare Aaron and Katie as husband and wife. I know Aaron is anxious for the next part. Before we get there, Aaron, it says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. They are no longer one. I mean, they're no longer two, but become one. Yes. And then it says, therefore, what God has joined together, let no one dare to separate it. Now, Aaron, that part, you may kiss your bride as your wife. Now the mission is on. It is my privilege and honor to introduce to you for the first time, husband and wife, Mr. and Mrs. Aaron and Katie Cruz.